This is a sweet horse, but he spooks a lot, and his owner was so frustrated, she was ready to give up on him.
He's only gotten progressively worse.
I'll show her some training techniques to help replace fearful behavior with curiosity. Annette, I got a chance to watch you ride around the place a little bit, and I see your horse can be a little bit of a handful sometimes. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about him. How old is he? How long have you had him?
He's 12 years old, and I've had him for 3 years. I bought him as a kid broke horse. My son wanted a horse. He wanted a black one. I know that you shouldn't buy a horse because of the color.
But, but he is a pretty color.
He is very pretty. And so we found an ad on Craigslist, and they advertised him as kid broke. They advertised him as a camp horse. I was working as an instructor at a children's farm day camp. And so it was sort of a double thing. I would get my son a kid broke horse, and I would use the horse at camp.
Almost sounds too good to be true, doesn't it?
It was too good to be
true. So you bought this horse sight unseen?
I went to see him, and they had him in a round pen. They had been running him and lunging him. And another lesson that I learned is you don't just ride the horse in the round pen, because he did great. We all rode him. My dad, my son, my husband, we all rode him. Took him home. It was totally different.
They were already working him before you got there?
Mm-hmm.
Red flag.
Yes. I know that now.
Okay, so you've had him 3 years. He was represented to you as a kid broke horse, but from the get-go, was he that way? Or
he was pretty spooky from the minute we took him off the trailer, and I just sort of thought that maybe it was, you know, new location, and we'd give it some time. Mm-hmm. He's only gotten progressively worse, I guess, and okay. We've worked with him a lot. A lot of ground training, a lot of de-spooking sort of things, and the thing about it is you just can never count on him, because you never know. He might not spook on tarp today, but he may spook tomorrow.
Right. You know, I watched as you rode. I watched as you walked him around the barn. This is not your home location, so everything was new to him. He seemed to be very interested in everything that was going on around him. I do think that's an issue we have to address. I saw several things I think we can do to improve upon. One is, I think we need to work on his looking around. He's a busybody. His mind is always going, and he wants to look at everything that's going on around him, and that's not his job. So he needs to learn that's not your job. You don't get to look around. I look around. You just follow me. So I think we need to do a little bit of groundwork in terms of establishing that rule. No looking around when I'm leading you. No looking around when I'm riding you. Probably we need to ramp up the ground manners work a little bit. I noticed that he wants to be behind you. When he's fearful, he wants to hide behind you. And that means he's moving towards you when he's afraid. That's something he should never do. So we'll work on ground manners with that. I'd like to change the bit for the simple fact that you're riding in a solid piece curb that is intended to be ridden only one-handed. And when you are having training problems with the horse, you need to go to two hands. So we need a bit that will support two-handed riding. Okay. I do want to keep you in the curb, because he is a Tennessee walker, and you need that elevation to be able to elevate the shoulders to get him to gait properly. But I want a curb that articulates so that you can ride two-handed more effectively.
Okay.
And then the third thing I want to do with you is teach you a bravery game for your horse. We cannot make him not spook. There's really no such thing as that. There's no such thing as de-spooking or bomb-proofing a horse, but we can make him deal with his fear a little bit better. And that's what I want to do through this game, is to teach him a different reaction when he becomes fearful.
Okay.
And so I want to show you how to do that from the ground, and then we're going to work on it from the saddle as well.
Okay.
It seems like you're at your wit's end with this horse.
I'm sort of at the point where this is the end of the road for me. I mean, I've tried for 3 years. I'm sorry. I've got 5 horses. He's the only one that does this. I'm afraid somebody's going to get hurt.
Sure. Well, that's a big deal. And I know the frustration must be huge, but I think we can fix this.
I hope so. I don't want to get rid of him.
Yeah, he's a nice horse.
He is.
We just need to teach him how to act.
And I'm afraid if I sell him, somebody will hurt him.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. Well, I think all the ingredients are there. We just got to get it mixed up right.
Okay. Thank you.
Annette, first thing is I would like you to get a little bit more strict on his ground manners. So even right there where he moved into me, unauthorized, that is absolutely zero tolerance for that.
Okay.
The second thing is looking around. Okay. So whenever I'm working with a horse on the ground or in the saddle, he needs to know some really fundamental rules. And one really important rule is you do not get to look around at everything in the world that is going on. You have to focus on me and the job in front of us.
Okay.
And so I want you to just discourage any looking around at all. Now, I don't, of course, if his nose is in front of him, he's fine to look around and he can turn his head just a little bit. It's when he picks his head up and looks way over there that I'm gonna have an issue with it. And all I'm gonna do is bump the rope and say, no, don't look over there. If you're riding and he turns his head to the left, bump the right rein and say, no, don't look over there. Stay focused on our job. Walk here with me down the road. The other thing is, and this is, these are two really common problems with horses that spook a lot, is that he is looking around and he's moving into you when he becomes nervous. That's normal, but it's not allowed. So he needs to learn. So right now, you don't get to move into me because there's something over there you don't like.
Okay.
I want him to be more focused on me and more concerned about me than anything else in his environment. So the two things I want you to address with your groundwork is no looking around. So anytime he, and I don't want you to stare at him, but try to sort of keep him in your sights while you're looking over here. And anytime he picks his head up to look something, just bump the rope. If he turns the head towards you, poke him in the nose. If he picks his head up to look over there, bump the rope and say, no, don't look around. And when I walk you somewhere, let's just turn around. I'm gonna turn him away from me to reinforce that moving out of my space. And anytime you become fearful, you don't get to just move on top of me. So I want you to keep the tail of your rope here long, and let's turn around again. And so anytime he just moves towards you, take the tail of your rope, reach back there and spank him and say, hey, no, you focus on me, not on that thing over there. You have more to worry about in pleasing me than you do about all this other scary stuff.
Okay.
Just those two things alone are gonna make a big impact in his spooking. If you give him more structure, more rules about how he acts, he'll start following them. He's a good horse, he'll do that.
Okay.
Next thing I wanna show you is a game I call the bravery game, and it's a de-spooking game. And so let's go get set up for that, and then I'll come back and show you how that works.
Okay, that sounds great.
To me, de-spooking is not about eliminating spooks because you can't do that. It's about teaching the horse how to deal with his fear in a different way.
Okay.
It's about replacing one behavior with another behavior. And the scientists refer to that as replacement training. And the fact of the matter is that the horse has a lot of instinctive behavior because they're prey animals, they're flight animals, they're very instinctive and reactive in their behavior. And of course, one of the instinctive behaviors of horses is flight. And we all know about that, and that's part of the problem here. But there is another set of instinctive behaviors of horses that not many people know about, and it's called investigative behavior. And I'm sure you've seen that plenty of times in horses. Mm-hmm. Once a horse decides that something isn't going to kill him and eat him, the next thing he wants to do is check it out,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right?
So horses are very naturally curious animals. But flight and investigative behavior are opposite behaviors. They cannot be in both modes at once. So if the horse is in flight, he has no investigative behaviors. If he is in investigative, he's not in flight. So to me, this whole bravery game that I'm going to show you is about teaching, converting the horse from flight behavior to investigative behavior, rewarding and praising and encouraging investigative behavior, making a game out of it, and discouraging and eliminating flight behavior.
Okay.
So we're gonna start on the ground. I'm gonna show you how it works. I've set up a scary little thing down there.
Okay.
It's just some plastic trash bags with some aluminum cans in it and something not terribly artificial, but that I'm hoping he'll notice. And we can go ahead and start and I'll explain it as I do. So in the beginning of this game, we're gonna set something up.
Okay.
Later on, it won't be a setup. There'll be real things on the trail or whatever that you'll be dealing with. But right now, we're setting up. So we got the scary thing down there. We started pretty far away from it because I want time to do some schooling and some training between here and there. So let's start walking. Okay. I'm just going to walk him straight towards the object. And I'm just going to kind of wait until I don't want to stare him down, but I want to observe his behavior. And at some point when he starts noticing it, I'm going to say, whoa. I'm just going to go ahead and have him take a step back. And then I'm going to say, good boy, you did just what I said. I told you to stop, you stopped, and now you get praise. No looking around over there. Two things are happening here. One is I gave him the command to stop, and he stopped, so I have an obedient horse. And I'm praising his obedience. The other thing that's going on here is he has time to look at this thing. Mm-hmm. If he tries to look away or he tries to leave, I'm going to reprimand him. But as long as his interest is forward, I'm going to say, good boy. And then we're going to take a few more steps. I'm going to ask you to come forward. Good job. You remained obedient. And then I'm going to ask you to stop. Good job. Pet on him. Praise on him. Give him just a minute to look at this thing. And you can often cue your horse to relax by taking a deep breath yourself. And I could also cue him to startle, you know, by doing something like that. But so as I'm letting him stop, I'm rewarding him for being obedient, I'm praising him, and I'm giving him just a minute to relax. And so as you're riding, you may have a little, this might be more of a challenge because as you're riding, you're not on the ground to protect him. Okay, now right here is the moment where flight behavior clicked into investigative behavior. Did you see him sort of put his head down and look at that thing? Mm-hmm. So that is the investigative behavior. So in the beginning, I always want to praise his forward interest. Now he's got enough interest in it where he's kind of wanting to go there. And so here's where the critical part comes in this exercise. I'm going to take a couple of steps closer. And when I feel him sort of get sucked into it, I'm going to say, whoa. No, you can't look at it just quite yet. You can't get there just quite yet. Okay. But I'll tell you when you can. That's good. That's good you're interested, and that's good you're brave. And so I'm going to hold him off of it for a few steps to sort of stimulate his curiosity. Good boy. Now, he doesn't seem overly afraid of this thing. But the ultimate prize comes when he reaches out and touches it. Mm-hmm. That's the end of the game. He won. If I can get him to approach it and reach out and touch it, he won the game. Okay? Let's go find a little scarier object, and I'm going to have you approach it and see what happens.
Okay. That sounds good.
Okay. Always enforce your ground manners. So whenever he starts moving towards you, take that rope and correct him. And let's just go ahead and stop. So the idea of stopping is to maintain the horse's obedience. So if I try to push him up here too fast, he's going to stop and balk, and now mm-hmm. I have a disobedient horse. So now he's looking at it. I got the umbrella there. That's a little different scenario here. So here we go. We're going to take a few steps closer and then ask your horse to stop. And then pray. Now push him off of you. Say, no, just because there's something scary out there, you don't get to lose your ground manners. I still expect you to stay off of me. And just praise him, pet him a little bit. You asked him to stop and he stopped. Good boy. The more we praise him, the more confidence we build. Now see how he's starting to get sucked into it already? Mm-hmm. And now let's approach again. But as he becomes sucked into this thing and interested in it, we're going to stop him still. And that's going to keep his interest up. Because pretty soon he's going to be saying, but I want to go there. And you're going to say, no, not yet. I'll tell you when. No, but I want to go there. So try it again. Approach. Go ahead. Keep walking forward. Don't look at him. Okay. And now ask him to stop. Whoa. And praise him. Good boy. Take a deep breath. And we're going to approach again. So just a couple of steps at a time. Every time you stop him, he's remaining obedient and he is reminded of his manners. Good. Praise him. Head down is good. Tell him he's a good boy. What a good brave boy. Horse you good are.
Good boy.
Now, our goal is that he gets so interested in this thing that he wants to reach out and touch it. And it might move when he does, but still go ahead and make a fuss of it. So take him
when
a couple.
When he's snorting, should I stop or go?
Don't go while he's snorting. But let him look it. Let him check it out. If he's, as long as he's got interest in that thing, you should be praising his forward interest. Okay. That's the investigative behavior. So go ahead and approach. We want to eliminate flight behavior. In other words, you don't get to leave. Good boy. Good boy. Tell him he's a good boy.
Good
Use
boy.
Your voice.
Good boy.
Good boy. Good boy. Yeah. Now see him wanting to get closer? Turn mm-hmm. his nose.
Oh, sorry.
Say, no, you don't get to leave. Your nose has to stay pointed at the thing always. But you don't get to leave, but you can approach it if you want to. So go ahead and take him a step closer.
Come on, Shadow.
Good boy. You Come can on. Step a little bit to the side. He said, I don't want to go over the top of it, but good boy.
Good boy.
Now, big praise
good
for touching
boy.
It. Good boy.
Good boy.
What a
good
boy. Okay,
like,
head down.
Yeah, you can tell he's still a little apprehensive.
Yeah, look at that. He dropped
boy.
His head. He's licking and chewing. He's
good.
Relaxing. Okay, now you can go ahead and take him away, and we're going to set up something new. I want you to practice this, several different obstacles, practice this from the ground, and then we'll start it all over again in the saddle.
Okay.
When I come back and check on you tomorrow, I want you to be approaching some scary things from the saddle.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
All right. No, no. Cause right, left, and back is not an option. Mm-mm. Not an option. So. But right now, my goal is not to push him up on this thing. My goal is to say, you can't back, whoa. So as soon as he started moving forward, I stopped him. And I just want to release the reins, because right now, that was good. Right now, if I held the reins tight, I would be conveying fear to him. And I want to take a deep breath, you know, make sure I'm not tensed up and keyed up.
Grove River Ranch in the mountains of northeast Georgia features stables, an indoor arena, a cabin to rent, lodging in the campground and bunkhouse, and miles of trails to ride or hike. It's perfect for clinics, workshops, and just getting away.
And that Shadow is a whole different horse today.
Yes,
I was glad I had a chance to ride him last night and show you the things that I would do as a trainer. And he was really good. I spent a little time correcting him for looking around. That's where the bit change came into play. So I was able to use my reins independently. I got him to walk up to the banner and reach out and touch it. That was because of the groundwork you had done. And next thing I know, we're riding up to a waving flag, and he had a little bit of conflicting emotions there. He was afraid, but he's being drawn into the curiosity. So that was really great. I thought we made an incredible amount of progress in a short amount of time with him.
He is a different horse today than he was yesterday, and I can't wait to get back home and work with him. How long will he be afraid of these things? How long do I have to play the bravery games? Is that forever with him?
No, it shouldn't be at all. And what you'll find is a snowballing effect. As he gains, the more you do the bravery game with him, the more he gains confidence, the more he likes that feeling of bravery, mm-hmm. and the more you'll see the fear factor diminish. I'm not gonna lie to you and say he's never gonna spook again, because he is a flight animal. But it's what he does with that spook that matters. So, and you'll see it's gonna be gradual improvement, but it'll definitely be a snowballing effect. By this time next year, this is gonna be a distant memory to you.
Well, I think because of you, I'm gonna keep him.
Well, good. I think he's a good horse, and I think you should keep him.
Thank you.
One of the first things a young horse in training needs to learn is to move freely forward and not break gait, especially at the canter. You'll need a large space to canter, and he needs to go fast, and it's important that he knows when he's done the wrong thing